So I'm going to talk to you about, as surgeons, how we treat melanoma. And one thing that's new, meaning the last 10 years, is that we do a lot less surgery for melanoma in terms of the scope of the surgery. And we pay a lot more attention to minimizing the surgery, being more non-invasive, and being much better at cosmetics. So there's really no reason for someone to be afraid of surgery when they have melanoma. So the way we treat melanoma at the Perlmutter Cancer Center is through a multidisciplinary approach. And basically, dermatologists are the folks and primary care doctors that pick up most of the melanomas, and they usually take care of them themselves if they're less than 1 millimeter thick. Surgeons get involved when the melanomas exceed 1 millimeter in thickness, and medical oncologists like Dr. Pavlik, that's going to speak to us after I complete my talk, take care of patients whose melanomas have spread or melanomas that are greater than 4 millimeters thick. So not everyone that has a melanoma needs to see someone like me, and not everyone that has a melanoma needs to see someone like Dr. Pavlik, but it's nice to have everyone together in one medical center if we need that. And so I'm just going to review a couple of topics that are pertinent to the surgical talk. And again, Dr. Hale went through this, but the thing to know is the incidence of melanoma is increasing. And I think that's really due to two factors. One is people really like to get tan in the 1960s and 70s. It became very in vogue and very good. And I think also, as Dr. Hale pointed out, it seems to be that burst of sun exposure that you get once or twice a year that causes a burn that leads to this. And what happened in the 60s and 70s is that airline travel became affordable for everyone. And so more people like my parents could take us down to Florida and watch their kids get burned with reflectors. And so we're seeing that increase in melanoma now. Risk factors Dr. Hale went through, ABCD, E-rule, again, very proud of the fact that that was developed at NYU and that's being used all over the world. So practically what happens is we talk about complete excisions and incomplete excisions. So we're very often asked to see a patient that had a biopsy performed by another doctor. And there's a big difference between a melanoma or a lesion that's been completely removed versus a melanoma that's been incompletely removed. And a lot of people will come to us angry that their dermatologist or their doctor didn't remove the whole thing. But really the goal of a primary care doctor and a dermatologist at the beginning is to sample the lesion and come up with a diagnosis. So the fact that the dermatologist didn't remove the whole thing is really not the point. They made the diagnosis. If the melanoma is thin and they like to do surgery, they'll take care of it. They'll never get to us. And if the melanoma is deeper or they don't like to do procedures, the patient gets sent to us. But really, the first doctor you interface with, removing the whole thing is not always the right thing to do. And the thickness of a melanoma really gives us a tremendous amount of information. And as the melanoma thickness increases, the survival of the melanoma patient goes down. However, Dr. Pavlik's going to point out there have been a lot of really new exciting things in the treatment of melanoma that may make this less true. The melanomas are staged the way all tumors are staged, and I put this slide up merely to show you how difficult this is and how precise it's getting. The staging system was revised several years ago to recognize that we're much better at picking out prognostic factors in melanoma, and we're much better at deciding which patient gets what treatment. So the margins of excision for a melanoma are important. So this is a melanoma in the center that's formed satellite metastases. And this is a quality that's almost unique to melanoma, and this is why simply scraping off or removing a melanoma with a tiny margin does not work, because melanoma cells jump away from the melanoma very quickly and can spread to other parts of the body. Basal cell and squamous cell carcinomas can be removed with Mohs surgery or simply removing them with a microscopic margin. This does not work with melanoma, and this is the reason why. And once this happens, it's very difficult to cure the patient. So in the early 1900s, we were doing 5 centimeter margins for melanomas. In the 1960s, we were doing 15 centimeter margins, which is about 8 inches. In 1977, we started to really say we don't really need to do these big disfiguring operations on people with melanoma because it didn't really accomplish anything. And there have been numerous studies, literally hundreds of them now, looking at removing melanomas with thin margins versus melanoma removal with large margins. And we really saw that thinner melanomas under 1 millimeter really didn't recur if they were resected with narrow margins. We then did studies with melanomas that were thicker, so this is a very good prospectively randomized study that was done in the UK, looking at melanomas that were less than a millimeter and less than 2 millimeters, and essentially this randomized patients to narrow wide margins and wider margins, and it essentially showed that when you cone down on your margin, they're apt to recur a few times more, but the survival is the same. And this is, again, another study done with thicker melanomas, but the basic premise is that narrow margins up to a point lead to more local recurrences with no adverse impact on survival. And so the recommended margins for excision right now are the following: for in situ lesions, which are the earliest melanomas that do not yet have the ability to spread, we remove them with a 5 millimeter margin. This can almost always be done in the office under local anesthesia. When melanomas are 1 millimeter thick, we use a 1 centimeter margin. When they're 1 to 4 millimeters thick, we do a 2 centimeter margin. And when they're greater than 4 millimeters, we do a 3 centimeter margin with some caveats and little tricks that we have. What makes melanoma so dangerous is that it can and does spread to every part of the body, and in people that die of melanoma, if you do an autopsy, you can find melanoma in virtually every organ. But the commonest place for melanoma to spread is to the lymph nodes, and so surgically there's been a big effort to decide how much surgery someone needs in terms of removing their lymph nodes when they come in with a melanoma. And are we trying to cure the patient? Are we trying to stage them? Are we trying to select them for immunotherapy trials? Or are we trying to merely reduce the tumor version and palliate them so that they're more comfortable? Now, this is a patient that has a large lymph node under their arm, and that's about a 6-inch diameter lymph node, and we know that patients like this have a lot of melanoma in their body. And there's a big difference between someone that comes in with a palpable or feelable spread of the lymph nodes and someone that has a non-palpable lymph node. And so it's the people whose melanoma is spread microscopically to the lymph nodes that seem to do better than people that have large lymph nodes. The people with large lymph nodes clearly need surgery, but what about those patients that we know have microscopic spread? And again, there have been literally hundreds of studies done over the last 70 years where people have a wide local excision, WLE, and elective lymph node dissection that's removing all the lymph nodes when you feel that the lymph nodes are negative, and you can see the 5-year survivals are all over the place. Some people do better when you remove the lymph nodes electively, some do the same, and some actually do worse. And so in 1993, NYU participated in the original trial of sentinel lymph node biopsy that was developed by the Santa Monica Cancer Center under Donald Morton. We were able to predict which lymph nodes are the most likely ones to have melanoma in them and remove them selectively. And this was described again by the John Wayne Cancer Institute in 1992. And this study completely changed the entire field of surgical oncology. We started with melanoma here in 1993, and I said we were one of the first groups that adapted this. This was then adapted to change the treatment of breast cancer and other cancers. And so what essentially happened is that New York University participated in this big study. And essentially what happens is in the morning or the evening before the procedure, the area around the melanoma is injected with a radioactive dye called technetium that travels to the first lymph node in the chain of lymph nodes that we call the sentinel lymph node. And because of the molecular weight of this dye, it gets trapped in the lymph node, it gets stuck there, and it makes that lymph node radioactive for several hours. It does not mean that there's melanoma there, but it means this is the most likely place for the melanoma to have gone. We have a gamma detector, which is we call it a neoprobe, but it's a Geiger counter essentially, that beeps really loud when you're right over the lymph node in question. And this is a blue dye that we inject at the time of surgery. Once the patient's anesthetized, it gives us two different ways to find the lymph node, one by blue staining and one by radioactivity. We mark out our excision margin on the left, which is the upper picture, and we know that the melanoma is going to map to the groin, so we can make a tiny incision there. And we look for a lymph node that's blue and radioactive, and we take it out. And the reason why we want to just remove one lymph node is the more we monkey around in your armpit or the groin, the more likely you are to get arm swelling called lymphedema, which everybody wants to avoid. We send the lymph node to the pathologist while the patient's still in the operating room. They cut it in half. If we see lots of melanoma in it, we know there's a problem, and in that case, we'll remove the rest of the lymph nodes, because in a situation like this, there's a 20% chance other lymph nodes are involved in the area. But if the lymph node does not have any black cells in it, We'll send it for processing. They'll do an H&E stain and an immunostain called an S100 stain on representative slices of the lymph node. And these are two very good stains that we can pick up little clusters of cells. So now we're so good that we can see a lymph node on the bottom that's filled with melanoma, which is a red stain, versus a cluster of melanoma cells in the lymph node, which is the B panel. And in the A panel, we can now pick up just one or two or three cells in the lymph node. And we would have called these lymph nodes negative several years ago. And now we know there's a problem. So the biggest question that we get from dermatologists or other doctors is, does my patient with a melanoma need a lymph node removed, or can we just remove the melanoma and leave them alone? So the ideal candidate for sentinel lymph node biopsy are those patients with melanomas 1 millimeter thick or greater with no evidence of lymph node spread. So their lymph nodes feel clean. They have no evidence of melanoma anywhere else in their body. And we can do a lymphoscintigraphy test and show that we can figure out which lymph node is the right lymph node to remove. People that have had very wide excisions of the melanoma already are not candidates for this procedure because we can't accurately map them. And this happens sometimes when a patient gets sent to a plastic surgeon that does a big excision and a reconstruction of the area. And there are other situations where patients are not great candidates. We don't do this procedure in patients with very thin melanomas because the chance we cause lymphedema is much greater than the chance we find anything worth knowing. We don't do this when the patient has metastatic melanoma or a palpable lymph node that we know is melanoma. And we don't really like to do this in pregnant patients, although melanoma is one of the commonest cancers in pregnancy, as is breast cancer. And we do sentinel lymph node biopsies in patients with melanoma and breast cancer. Interestingly, with radioactive dye seems to be much safer than the blue dye we use. So you will do this with radioactive dye, which is very fleeting, but we do not use blue dye in these patients. Any procedure has complications. These usually occur in family, friends, well-known people, people that work here, essentially. And it can happen intraoperatively. We can have dye reactions, bleeding. Sometimes we can't find the lymph node. This sometimes happens when the melanoma is in the face and the lymph node's in the neck. We can have postoperative bleeding, fluid collections, numbness and pain, and about 5% of patients get lymphedema. So even if we remove one lymph node, 5% of patients will still get swelling of the leg, which may go away, may not go away. And in less than 10% of patients, the lymph node reads out negative, but they can have a recurrence later in that area. So we're seeing more and more patients now with thin melanomas that are sent to us, and the question is, whose melanoma has the ability to spread, and so which patients need to have lymph nodes removed to see what's going on. And if you look from this conglomeration of studies that I put together, melanomas that are less than 0.76 millimeters almost never spread to the lymph nodes, okay? Melanomas that are between 0.75 and 1 millimeter do metastasize to the lymph nodes in about 1 to 10% of patients, depending on where you read. And so when you look at other factors in these patients with thin melanomas, it seems to be that patients with thin melanomas that are ulcerated, that have a mitotic rate greater than 1, meaning we see cells dividing under the microscope, with cells that look like they're on their way to the lymph nodes, or patients that have had biopsies where the pathologist says, you know, it is thin, but there's a lot underneath, seem to be those patients that need to have the sentinel lymph node biopsy procedure. So essentially, in our group at NYU, we do not offer this procedure to patients with thin melanomas less than 0.8 millimeters. We offer it to patients with melanomas greater than 1 millimeter. And when it's 0.8 to 1, it's sort of a judgment call based on the histologic criteria associated with that melanoma. So I just like to acknowledge we have a big conglomerative group at NYU called the IMCG. We have about 3,200 patients now enrolled from NYU that have enrolled in our studies. We've collected over 24,000 specimens from patients that we use in research. And we have many publications now across the whole university, which is a really nice thing. And I just also like to, I missed that slide, but the Marc Jacobs Foundation, the designer, has given us now over $5 million for melanoma research at NYU. So we're really very grateful to them. And thank you for coming to our talk.